Hello friends, welcome to Smart Catalyst. Today we'll be seeing the current affairs of 27th October 2018. The topics we'll be covering for prelims are these seven. First one is about the World Agricultural Prize to eminent scientist M.S. Swaminathan. The second article is about a social gathering called as Mushaira organized by Ministry of Minority Affairs. Third one deals with India National Organic Festival. Fourth one is CCTNS. Fifth one deals with Commerce Ministry's working on export incentives. Sixth one deals with India-Myanmar road connectivity projects, and the last one is about strategic surveillance system installed in Andaman Island. And we'll also be seeing three topics for mains. The first one is about India-Japan relationship. The second topic talks about the introduction of NRC in the state of Tripura. And the third article talks about Ottawa talks relating to WTO matters. The first article we'll be seeing is First World Agricultural Prize to eminent scientist Professor M.S. Swaminathan. This was taken from PIB. So this World Agricultural Prize has been instituted by an Indian organization called as India Council of Food and Agriculture. So this was given to M.S. Swaminathan as a recognition to his service towards mankind through agriculture and allied services. So M.S. Swaminathan played a very important role in bringing high yield varieties of wheat and rice seedings to poor farmers of Indian country. Thereby he interconnected lab to fields in Indian farmers. This played a very great role in mitigating the hidden hunger problem, which was greatly prevailing in India in 1960s, as well as it also addressed the issue of nutrition. It made India self-reliant with respect to the agricultural producers and transformed India to a greater extent in socio-dynamically. M.S. Swaminathan also played a very great role in ensuring the protection and conservation of plant genetic resources, which are crucial to maintain the biodiversity in our country. So especially in 21st century, when there are increasing talks about climate change and sustainable development goals, it is highly important that the work of M.S. Swaminathan in the sphere of green revolution gets translated to evergreen revolution, thereby bringing in prosperity to our country. The second article we'll be seeing is about Mushaira. So this article was also taken from PIB. So what is Mushaira? Mushaira is a poetic symposium. It is an event where people gather and perform their poetic works. So this Mushaira is a very important part of Urdu literature, which is very much prevalent in the people living in Pakistan, North India and even Deccan region of India. So this festival is currently organized by Ministry of Minority Affairs and was held in Mumbai. And this was a part of national wide commemoration of 150th anniversary of the father of nation, that is Mahatma Gandhi. So, and the theme of this symposium was based on teachings and principles of Mahatma Gandhi. The third article we'll be seeing is 5th Women of India National Organic Festival. This article was also taken from PIB. So this festival is celebrated to promote women entrepreneurs and farmers in the field of organic farming across India. This festival was organized by Ministry of Women and Child Development. So across world, there is increase in awareness about the organic produce. And there is also increase in demand for organic produce. And if you take India, India contributes almost 30% of the total organic products across the world. And usage of these organic methods can increase the farmers' income by about 50% in years to come. So in this direction, the Ministry of Women and Child Development has sought a proposal to integrate the organic products via e-marketing portal called as Mahila eHut. So we have to know what Mahila eHut is for the prelims exam. So this Mahila eHut is a web portal to meet the aspirations of young women entrepreneurs. So this portal uses technology as a tool to bring in socio-economic change in the lives of women and thereby empowering them. It is a very important tool to promote financial inclusion by supporting the creativity of women. It is also a very important initiative to support India's Make in India program. The next article we'll be seeing is about crime and criminal tracking network systems. This article was taken from Indian Express. So what is this CCTNS? This CCTNS is a project under Indian government aimed at creating a comprehensive and integrated system in order to bring in effective policing in India. And this is made via using technology. So this CCTNS is a mission mode project under National E-Governance Plan of Government of India. It aims to automate police function at police station and even at higher levels. And this project will be implemented by National Crime Records Bureau. And it will integrate more than 14,000 police stations across India. It will provide various facilities and mechanisms such as registration of online complaints, asserting status of cases registered in different police stations, as well as verification of persons, etc. By providing these services, this CCTNS will enhance the efficiency and effectiveness of the police service. The next article we'll be seeing is Commerce Ministry working on export incentives. This article was taken from Mint. So the Ministry of Commerce is working on various methods in order to boost Indian exports, but we are giving various export incentives. So this move of Commerce Ministry is aimed to make Indian markets more competitive. So if you see this graph, India has been facing considerable trade balance. Though this trade balance is marginally reduced in the year 2015 and to 2017, still India suffers a huge trade balance with respect to most of the countries. So in order to address this issue, the Commerce Ministry has aimed to make Indian exporters more competitive, especially by competing with other exporters who enjoy some kind of free trade agreement with respect to few countries. By providing this export incentives, it aims to partially compensate the partial disadvantage they face due to the free trade agreements which the countries have while trading. So the direction of Commerce Ministry is specifically targeted towards certain sectors like engineering, jewelry and gems, textiles, pharmaceuticals, chemicals, where India has a stronghold. With the changing global scenarios like trade wars and increasing ideology of protectionism, it is very important that India increases its exports and thus maintains its self-reliance. The next article we'll be seeing is India-Myanmar road connectivity. This article was taken from PIB and it talks about India-Myanmar transport connectivity projects. So there has been discussions between India and Myanmar with respect to the India-Myanmar and Thailand trilateral highway. So this trilateral highway, it connects Indian city of Moray in Manipur to Thailand city of Masut. So this roadways, it travels via Myanmar, covering cities like Mandalay, Kalewa and Monyawa. This trilateral highway is very important for India's Act East policy and also important for India's engagement with ASEAN. So there's yet another important project with respect to India and Myanmar, which is called as Kaladan Multimodal Transit Agreement. So that project, it connects city of Kolkata to Sitwe in Myanmar. It also aims to increase the bilateral trade between India and Myanmar. The main aim of this Kaladan project is to increase the connectivity of northeastern India with mainland India. And another important connectivity service is Impal-Mandla bus service between India and Myanmar. And there's also talks about bilateral motor vehicle agreement between the two countries in order to increase the connectivity. The next article we'll be seeing is Strategic Surveillance System in Andaman Island. This article was taken from Indian Express. So the Union Environmental Ministry has approved the establishment of a surveillance systems by DRDO in South Andaman's Rustlen Island. So here in Ruslan Island, DRDO is planning to establish a long-range missile facility. So the Ruslan Island is located in southern Andamans. So here is Ruslan Island. On its right, it has Andaman Sea. And it is closely located to many ecologically diverse areas like Mahatma Gandhi Marine National Park, Red Sea Skin Island, and even Joy Boy Island. All these areas are very rich in coral reefs. So this project has high strategic significance. As it deals with India's security, so this Ruslan Island is located at about 200 km from Strait of Malacca, which connects Indian Ocean with South China Sea. This area linking Indian Ocean and South China Sea, that is the Strait of Malacca, is a very strategically important area as it carries about almost 80% of the world trade via oil ships. So ensuring security of this area is very much important to maintain India's stand in that area. So the next article we'll be seeing is touching base on PM Modi's visit to Japan. This was taken from The Hindu. Indian Prime Minister Modi will be visiting Japan for 12th annual meeting. So this is 12th in the set of institutionalized annual summits which have been happening from the year 2006. In the year 2014, India and Japan has elevated their relationship to special strategic and global partnership. However, the changing global trends pose different threats to the relationship between India and Japan. So let's now discover the world dynamics. The first is the US factor. The US government has been taking various measures recently which have affected the global trade dynamics. The first one is their recent action on trade tariffs. For example, take into consideration the generalized system of preferences. So this GSP is a preferential service offered by the United States of America government to certain developing countries like India. So the current US government has reviewed this GSP with respect to India, which will definitely affect India's exports to USA. The second dynamic situation is the sanctions imposed by USA against Iran and Russia. So we all know about the agreement CARTSA, that is countering adversaries of America through sanctions. This agreement proposes to impose sanctions on various countries who are having trade connections with certain countries like Iran and Russia, who are considered as adversaries to America. The third factor is the US exit from various multilateral as well as security regimes. For example, take into consideration US exit from Trans-Pacific Partnership. So the exit of US from TPP has created a huge void which may be exploited by China. And this will in turn escalate other security issues. And the fourth factor is restrictions on visa of professionals. So this H-1B visa issue is very important, especially with respect to India. And this has affected the relationship between India and USA. And the second factor is with respect to China. We all know China's Belt and Road projects, which has been pushing many countries into debt trap. So by using this debt trap diplomacy, China is pushing many developing and underdeveloped countries into debt trap and thus increasing its influence all over the world. So this is posing security threat to various countries across the globe. And another issue is the South China Sea issue. China is building various artificial islands as well as other infrastructure projects in South China Sea, which is affecting the free navigation in the South China Sea area, which poses threat to not just Japan but also other island countries in that area. So in this scenario, how India and Japan can increase their engagement? Number one is the India-China project of Asia-Africa Growth Corridor. So this Asia-Africa Growth Corridor is seen as the alternative to China's Belt Road projects and China's increasing investment in Africa. So this Asia-Africa Growth Corridor is seen as the alternative to increasing Chinese investment in the continent of Africa. And this has potential to increase the trade and decrease the navigation cost between India and Africa. Shinkansen bullet train project as well as the purchase of US 2 amphibious aircraft, both of these proposed projects has potential to increase the engagement between India and Japan. And there's also increasing defense cooperation between the two countries via various military exercises like Malabar, which is a trilateral exercise between US, India and Japan. And also the government of India and the government of Japan will be conducting a new bilateral exercise in the state of Meghalaya. And another naval exercise, JIMEX, was also recently organized between the navies of India and Japan. All these will definitely increase the defense cooperation between the two countries. Both India and Japan, they have same ideals of democracy, tolerance as well as pluralism. So increased engagement between India and Japan is very much essential to increase the investment into India as well as to maintain peace in Indo-Pacific region. The next article we'll be seeing is Proceed with Caution. This was taken from Hindu. And this article talks about the call for National Registry of Citizens for the state of Tripura, just like what the government did for the state of Assam. So this call for NRC for Tripura, it is a manifestation of high demographic fault lines across not just Tripura, but all northeastern states which are bordering Bangladesh. So if you see map of India, Bangladesh is bordered by Indian state of Tripura, Assam, Meghalaya, as well as West Bengal. And all these four states, they face increasing flux of migrants from Bangladesh for past several decades. And Article 6 of Indian Constitution, it talks about citizenship rights in India. And the petitioners from the state of Tripura for NRC call for using 1948 July 19 as a cutoff date to demarcate the entry of migrants into the state of Tripura. So the problem of refugee crisis in the northeastern states is manifested via various reports. Successive census reports as well as official records, they show the large-scale migration which is prevalent from this country of Bangladesh into India from 1960s. So the state of Tripura, if you take, is a state dominated by scheduled tribes. It is an ethnically diverse state, rich in language, culture, as well as religion. If you take empirically to analyze this state, so the scheduled tribes, they constituted 52% of the total population of the states in 1901. But due to excessive influx of migrants from the state of Bangladesh, the ethnic population has been reduced to 31% according to census 2011. And this causes increasing regionalistic feelings across the local people, which is in turn manifested via increasing conflicts in the most of northeastern states. So in this light, the government has proposed a citizenship bill 2016. So this citizenship bill, it seeks to give citizenship status to 6 non-Muslim minority people from the states of Bangladesh, Pakistan and Afghanistan. So if this bill is implemented, Hindus, Sikhs, Christians, Buddhists, Jains as well as Parsis will get citizenship status in India. So another important factor is the Assam NRC factor. As we all know, the Assam NRC has been updated as per 1971 census recently, and this updation has caused a lot of confusion in the states. According to official records, almost 40 lakh people are excluded from the recently released NRC. And this NRC has also questioned the position of the descendants who have been living in the state of Assam for several years, which is a violation of their right to equality. And this whole situation can lead to a huge humanitarian crisis, which will affect the stability of our country. So this whole situation added to the proposed citizenship bill can pose a huge security threat to northeastern part of India. And India doesn't have any deportation treaty with the state of Bangladesh. Even if the illegal migrants are identified by creating NRC, we don't have a proper channel for deporting them back to the state of Bangladesh, which is another issue. So any change made with respect to state of Tripura has to be made by taking into consideration all these factors and in such a way that it avoids any imminent humanitarian crisis. So the last article we'll be seeing is trade chiefs say WTO no longer sustainable and pledge for reforms. So this article was taken from the paper Mint. So the leaders of 13 major economies, namely European Union, Japan, Canada, Norway, Switzerland, Australia, New Zealand, Singapore, South Korea, Kenya, Brazil, Mexico and Chile, they met recently in Ottawa in Canada. So in this meeting, they ascertained that WTO is no longer sustainable and they call for new methods for trade negotiation, taking into consideration the evolving global trends. So in this meeting, four important countries, China, India, South Africa and Indonesia, were purposely not invited as these countries face conflict of interest with other 13 major economies. So India has always opposed the attempts to initiate new trade negotiations without finishing the Doha round of talks. And India has also opposed any talks outside the ambit of WTO. The 13 member countries who met recently, they lodged plurilateral negotiations, especially dealing with five areas. First is with respect to e-commerce, that is electronic commerce industry. Second is to increase the investment. Third deals with the MSME sector. There was also increasing negotiations to dealing with domestic service regulation as well as gender and trade area. So according to these 13 countries, the new way of talks, it creates a level playing field by making the talks more flexible, open and providing new approaches in order to face the new market realities. Thank you.